see. What was I going to... Oh, yes, I was going to tell you. Oh, it's sport night here, isn't it? I forgot. Yes, indeed. Well, you know, Howard Cosell always forgets that he's talking about sports since I was talking about his book, right? But it's sport night here tonight. And in answer to a question, we have an angry listener who writes, Shepard, what the hell is a hat trick? I keep seeing that referred to constantly in these various rags that are masquerading as papers in this neighborhood. And he keeps saying that Gilles, somebody, made a hat trick again. What is a hat trick? I'll bet you don't know. Oh, the hell I don't. And in answer to many of your questions, you've probably wondered what a hat trick is. I'm going to tell you, I do know what a hat trick is. And as a matter of fact, you're listening to one of the very few deep, perceptive commentators on the scene who participated in a hat trick. No. Did not score a hat trick. Wasn't even on the ice. But participated in the hat trick. Now, you're going to say, how is that possible? That shows that you do not know what a hat trick is, if you ask that. A hat trick is really a Zen concept. For those of you who are curious about it, why Zen? Well, you know one of the old Zen paradoxes, or is it paradai? Please allow me to hear the sound of one hand clapping. Right? You've heard that? Doesn't make any sense, does it? Well, then the hat trick won't make any sense to you either. The hat trick is a state of mind. Now, what is the hat trick? Well, I will reproduce a hat trick for you. Now I'll show you another one that David Steinberg could not even remotely approach. Get ready with your crowd in there, Herb. Okay, I will be the commentator. You know, the guy that's doing the play-by-play. Imagine now that you are in a great, vast arena filled with 15,000 screaming maniacs who have all paid twice as much as they should have for the tickets to get in to see this club, right? And it is a key high point of the evening, which comes late in the third quarter. Suddenly we hear... And there he is! Gilles Merritt is now going over the blue line! He's sweeping into the defense! What a backhand shot! He scores! It's a hat trick! He put it right past the goalie! A magnificent hat trick! Gilles Merritt, a hat trick tonight! All right, okay. We'll let David Steinberg try that one. I'm pretty damn good, friends, and you're learning it. Okay? You like that? It sounded real, didn't it? Well, that's talent. Man, I like this, damn it. That's not real. All right, now, you wonder what happened there at that moment. Do you want to try it again to show you? Now, we'll give you an instant replay so that you will listen carefully to what the commentator is saying. Listen carefully, and this is a replay, and it will give you an insight into some of the more mystical qualities of sport. You are once again back in the arena. It could be any one of 10, 15 arenas around the country. Let's say the Chicago Arena, where the Blackhawks are playing the Detroit Red Wings, right? We'll pick that team, okay? All right, here we go. And now Gilles Merritt is coming up over the blue line. He's moving down the sideboards. He's past the defense. What a backhand shot. He flipped the backhand right past the goalie. It's a hat trick. A hat trick for Gilles Merritt. His second one this season. Okay, all right. Pretty sensational, right? Just giving you, pulling out some of the stops here to let you know what talent is tonight, friends. All right, now, what was that? What occurred there at that moment? All right, Gilles brought the puck down across the goal line. He went along the boards, over to the left side, right? Skated across behind the defense. He got in through the defense, and he flipped in a backhand shot from about 20 feet out, past the goalie, a sensational shot, and what did he score? Well, yes, of course he scored a goal. But what did the commentator say at that point? All right, you want to hear it again? All right, we repeat. Here he goes in! What a shot! Gilles Merritt scored his third hat trick of the season! Another hat trick for Gilles Merritt! Okay. It's even better that time, wasn't it? It's getting better all the time. All right, Gilles scored a hat trick. Now, what is a hat trick? Now, to most of you who are really superficial sport fans probably think a hat trick is merely scoring three goals. No, no. The question now arises, and our listener asked it very well, why do they call it a hat trick? That's going to throw you. See, all you smart guys who are saying, anybody knows it's three goals. Oh, no, friends, you do not know. So don't come around here and pretend you know anything, you know? Everywhere I look, I'm surrounded by ignorance. I'm surrounded by arrogant ignorance. I mean, I'm surrounded by aggressive ignorance. I mean, even Boughton, you know, the ineffable Boughton would probably say, anybody knows. Shepherd, once again, tried to prove, anybody knows a hat trick is three goals. I'm sorry, Boughton. A hat trick is much more than that. It's the sound of one hand clapping in the darkness. A hat trick, friends, involves hats. Did you know that? Yes, it does. It has long been a tradition in the great arenas of Canada, out where they really play hockey, where hockey is a religion. And I mean a religion that young children are inculcated in from birth. Many a kid, by the time he's maybe 3 or 4 weeks old, already is working on a slap shot. Can't walk. Can't talk, but he's got a hockey stick in his hand, and he's working away at that slap shot right there in the crib, right? This is a religion. By the time he's 4 or 5, that kid can outskate almost any American college hockey player already. Why? It's a religion. And like all religions, it has its mystical rites, rituals, that go back into the great mists of time. And only the true scholar, the true theologian of the sport, the true theologian of the movement understands, but only partially, only. One does not. You can go to your neighborhood bishop or priest and ask him the meaning of various pieces of vestment that the cardinals wear or the pope wears. He could give you only a superficial explanation, but he could not tell you how that evolved and why it evolved hundreds and hundreds of years ago. It would only be conjecture on his part. And we are not looking for conjecture, we are looking for truth. Conjecture is not to be confused with truth, right? Now, let us again once more go back to that scene. We will play it again for you so that you can carefully listen and see if you spot anything that is significant in the hat trick. Listen carefully.
Kielsberg now is going across the blue line. He's skating along the sideboards on the left side. He skates across behind the defense. What a slap shot! He's got that one past the goalie and scores a hat trick. A hat trick! What a night Gilles Merritt is having.
All right, he scored a hat trick. Now, what occurs at the moment of the scoring of a hat trick? The red light goes on, right? A fist fight breaks out behind the goal between two defensemen and a forward of the other team. But that's only icing on the cake. Three guys are carried kicking and dragging their feet and their skates into the penalty box. One guy is fined $200 for swearing at the referee. What what actually occurred? By the way, for those of you who are curious as to my background in this sport, I got to give you my credentials, that we spent more time playing hockey when I was a kid than we ever played baseball. Because the country I grew up in was frozen more than it wasn't. So it was just a natural period, quality of time. So we played hockey night and day. And every available type of shot was taken. We took turns being goalie. Because goalie, you know, being a goalie, honestly, I can't tell you how mean that position is. Being a goalie is like being a target on a U.S. Army rifle range. And it's about as thankless. And you get holes all over your body. you really do. That puck comes at you sometimes so fast that if you're not properly protected, its level will just make a neat round hole, go right through your thorax, leave right next to your backbone, go right on through, and make a hole in the net behind you. You know, just go right on. Maybe sometimes travel 3-4 miles I mean, just on the sheer flat to red trajectory, too. So I want to say that my background is somewhat chaotic, and I remember moments of rolling around, sprawling, sliding on the ice, and seeing ice skates going by, and sticks rising and falling, and feel them hit the neck. And that's what hockey remains and will be to me. Later on in life, one of the very first jobs I ever had in this business was doing major league, well, actually, it was major minor league, play-by-play hockey. I've actually done this. So I know whereof somewhere I speak. Now, what about the hat trick? You want to know about the hat trick? Well, a hat trick, I came across as a participant one time, I'll never forget it. My old man was a fanatical Chicago Blackhawks fan. Now, if you guys think that the Rangers have got fans, if you guys think that the Knicks have got fans, you have never encountered a Chicago Blackhawk fan in full heat. They are incredible. It's like a herd of angry rhinoceri, maybe 30 or 40 or 50 male rhinoceri in the heat and the very heart and the peak of the rutting season, and there's only one lady in the neighborhood. Well, you got some action. I want to tell you, these hockey fans were incredible, and about every 3 or 4 months, the old man would condescend to take me to one of these hockey games, which he went to every Sunday night when they were playing at home in the Chicago Arena. And you'd go in there, and of course, this hockey team, they wore these black suits. You ever seen the Hawks? Had great uniforms. It was black suits with orange stripes and a great big Indian on the front. And these guys all looked like they were 30 feet tall, about 9 feet wide, which is true. That's what they were. And one night, I was sitting right there in the crowd with the old man. We're up in the upper deck. The Chicago Blackhawks are playing the Detroit Red Wings, which was their deadly enemy at the time. When one of the Blackhawks broke through, and this is exactly what happened.
There goes Jim Merritt. He's over the blue line. He's going in for a solo shot. He's past the defense. A backhand flip. He's in. He scores. It's out. It's a hat trick. A hat trick.
Well, the fans went out of their bird. They're screaming and yelling. The old man reached up, grabbed his hat, and threw it right out in the arena. He flung that hat out onto the ice, and there were about 50 other hats flew out on the ice. Maybe 75, 100 hats flew out on the ice. And it was a fantastic. I looked up, you know. It's rare that you see your old man actually rip pieces of clothing off of him and hurl them into an arena. The old man threw his hat out into the ring. And what I remembered about it is that there had been an argument for about 3 weeks in our house about whether the old man could afford a new hat. He had just bought that hat 2 days before. He brought it home, and everybody says, that's a very good hat, you know. He had this great hat. He loved his hat. And in a moment of total ecstasy, he grabbed the hat that he had thought about buying for weeks, finally had gone in and spent a whole afternoon trying on hats. He finally bought it 2 days before. The first time he wore it, he threw it out in the arena. And now it's being swept up by the referees into another great big pile of hats that other guys threw into the arena at the moment of a hat trick. And that night, we got home. The old man has got no hat. My mother says, where's your hat? He says, no, well, man, I don't have it. She said, where'd it go? And I said, Ma, he threw it down on the ice. And she says, he did what? I said, he threw it down on the ice. And she turned to the old man. She says, why? Why'd you throw your hat down on the ice? He says, well, Gilles Merritt scored a hat trick. What can I do? She says, are you crazy? He says, you'll never understand. And that's the best explanation one can give for Zen Ag. You'll never understand. Either you understand or you don't. If you don't, you'll never understand. Forget, gang, tomorrow, 12:30, the Laurel Bookshop, 16 West, no, it's East 57th Street. We'll be there looking mean. No, it's West. It's East. It's West. That's a Theo, another Zen mystery.